we now take the same thing, the book of the 35th part, the book of the Acts of the Apostles, part 35. In our last meeting, we looked at the significance of the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We pluralized the word manifestation to be able to distinguish the significance of each manifestation. So we noted as follows that one, the sound from heaven, which was like that of a mighty rushing wind, was like a trumpet call or a siren to draw the attention of the people who were gathered at Jerusalem at this time. And it was because of all over the world that the Lord Jesus had commanded the disciples to tarry in Jerusalem until they be endued with power on high. So he announced by the sound, and the people gathered, and as a result of that, they were able to not only see what God was doing, but they heard the word of God on that day. Secondly, the cloven or divided tongues that seemed like fire, we said signified the work of the Holy Spirit in taking hold of all those who willingly present themselves to God, as it takes by the tongue or by speech, which is one of the major ways by which the saints are led. The Bible says if we do not offend in speech, we are pure. So the Holy Spirit takes control of our, took control of the tongues of men and began to lead and direct men. It also signified the work of sanctification of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer, body, soul, and spirit. That work begins with the tongue. The moment the tongue can be curbed, can be controlled, the rest is easy. Thirdly, we said the speaking in tongues, speaking in tongues by people who had not learned a language, that language they were speaking, they never learned it before, it displayed the desire and the power of God with all men, regardless of tribe or tongue. It began to tell men that God wants to speak to them. God wants to speak to all men. Nothing should differentiate. God wants to speak to all men. He's not a Hebrew speaking God only. He speaks every single language and wants to every single language. Fourthly, we spoke about, we mentioned in passing Peter's sermon because we said that we're going to speak more on it today. But Peter's sermon signified God's desire to explain to all of mankind his own desire for them to be reconciled to him through Jesus Christ. That was the essence of that Peter's sermon. To inform those men who were gathered that you may be of sin, yet God wants you to be reconciled to him. Being enemies of God, yes, that's true. But God still wants peace with men. And so the way by which he's bringing that peace is through the Lord Jesus Christ. Finally, we concluded by noting that even though we may not understand what God is doing, yet there is a purpose for everything that God does. And through the church, God's original plan of man having dominion over his creation is to be achieved only as the church take on the likeness and multiply that same likeness all over the earth. Remember, we mentioned what God said at the beginning. He said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Everything, including the creeping things and so on and so forth. And I think we mentioned at that time that the Lord Jesus said to them that I have given you authority to trample over snakes and scorpions and over all the enemy, all the world. So that is the place of the church. The church has been lifted high. The church is seated with Christ Jesus in heavenly places, far above principalities and powers. We have no business groveling on the ground and, you know, pursuing worldly things when we have been placed in a position of authority. Anyway, we move on today. Again, we still look at Acts chapter 2, but this time we are going to read a longer set of verses We're going to read from verse 1 through to verse 41. From verse 1 through to verse 41. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through verse 41. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all spirit other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speaking in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Egypt and the parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God." So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "Whatever could this mean?" Others mocking said, "They are full of new wine." But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, "Men of Judea, and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and heed my word. For these are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, that is, it's only between 8 and 9 in the morning. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel, 'And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, Spirit on all flesh, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall see visions, your old men shall dream dreams, and on my men servants and on my maid servants I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy.'" Another word for prophesy is they will speak forth from the throne of God. "And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke, into darkness and the moon into blood, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know, being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death, whom God raised up, having because it was not possible that he should be held by it. For David says concerning him, "I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence. Men and brethren, let me speak freely to you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on his throne, he, foreseeing this, spoke concerning the resurrection of the Christ, that his soul was not left in Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this and here. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men, what do we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified and explained this generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, as we mentioned last week, we shall be looking at the sermon Peter preached on the day the church was born. And what a message it was. It was unprepared. That is, it was spontaneous. But was it really an unprepared message? We'll open our eyes, our ears, our understanding as we study today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So we look at the birth of the church, our global theme, or rather our theme in this part, and we shall be looking at a sub-theme, the voice of Peter, the message of the Holy Spirit. The voice of Peter, the message of the Holy Spirit. Yes, the message Peter preached was spontaneous. As far as Peter and we, the listeners, are concerned, was a message that had been prepared long before, from the foundations of the earth. That message had been prepared. It had been prepared to have maximum impact. Don't forget, the Lord Jesus had said they should tarry in Jerusalem, because he knew that people would have gathered from all over the world, and he wanted a message that would impact all those people and bring as many as he would in to the body. Also, Peter had been prepared, even though the message was spontaneous, but Peter prepared for it by making himself available to the Spirit of God to do his work in him and through him. When they were gathered that day, it was like dry grass waiting for a combination of heat, little spark, and no humidity. All you will have is fire. So Peter had been prepared. So yes, the message was spontaneous, but both the vessel and that message were prepared by the Holy Spirit. And that's why we got the impact that we got. We're still looking at the intro of this thing. The voice of Peter, the message of the Holy Spirit. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 18 to 20, Matthew 10, 18 to 20, the Lord Jesus Christ had told the disciples long ago when he sent them out to preach two by two. He said, but he wasn't speaking of that time, he was speaking of now, in fact, this particular period, and even us now. He said, you will be brought before governors as a testimony to them and to the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, do not worry about how or what you should speak, for it will be given to you in that hour. It is not you who speak, but who? The Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. So that's why I say it was the voice of Peter we were hearing. But who was speaking really? The Spirit of God. It was the message of the Holy Spirit. We recall in Acts chapter 26, if you can read the whole Act, the whole, when Paul stood up and began to share to Agrippa, about how God called him and so on and so forth. By the time he finished, because he wasn't speaking from the spirit of a man. No, who was there? Was it Festus? Who was there? He said, Paul, too much learning has turned your head upside down. Because they couldn't understand that a man would be able to speak the way he spoke, with so much boldness, with so much clarity and understanding of the scriptures. In Acts chapter 4, we've looked at that also before, from verse 8 to about verse 14 thereabout, when Peter stood before the Sanhedrin and he began to speak after the man who was born lame, sitting at the gate, had been healed. So much so that the Sanhedrin said, the Bible says that when they took Peter and John were unlearned men, they were illiterates. Not only were they men of menial profession, fishermen, but they hadn't gone to school. And yet they were able to speak the way they spoke. Then the Bible says that they took cognizance of the fact that they had been with Jesus. They had been with Jesus. The Spirit of Christ had been upon them. In Luke chapter 21, I'm going to read that. Luke chapter 21, and I'm going to read from verse 12 to verse 15. Luke 21 from 12 to 15. That the Lord Jesus told them, and it's basically a repeat of Matthew 10, but this one was saying about the sign of the times when you would be, when the end will come. He said in verse 12, but before all these things, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. You will be brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. But it will turn out for you as an occasion for what? Testimony. It will turn out as an occasion to preach. It will turn out as an occasion to be a witness. Verse 14. Therefore, hearts, not to meditate beforehand on what you will answer. Settle it. Don't meditate about what you will answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries, not some, all your adversaries, will not be able to contradict or resist. So, no matter how, as long as it comes from the Holy Spirit, know that it's a prepared sermon. So even though we know this sermon as Peter's spontaneous sermon, yet it is in reality the message of the Holy Spirit. Or put more succinctly, the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's look at the message. And when I say looking at the message, we are not going to be breaking it down for the purpose of studying a sermon or homiletics of a sermon. No. We want to look at some crucial aspects of this sermon. Number one, you will recall that the people have asked the question, what can this mean? What could this be when they heard the tongues, right? And they heard the sound, they heard the tongues and so on. So, what can this possibly mean? So the first thing that this message did was to answer their curiosity, to answer the question in their hearts. Peter stood and said, this is what the prophet John about. The prophet John had prophesied about such a time when God will pour out his spirit upon all flesh, speak, prophesy by the authority and in the name of the Lord, and begin to speak forth as the Spirit of God will give them utterance. Said, this is that thing that Joel said, what you have witnessed is the manifestation of that prophecy. And I want to add, according to Numbers chapter 11, that this is an answer to Moses' prayers. And I'm going to tell you what that is. Numbers 11, verse 16 to 29. I'll read it. Don't worry. Let me just read it. So the Lord said to Moses, gather to me 70 men of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people, and officers over them. Bring them to the tabernacle of meeting, that they may stand there with you. Then I will come down and talk with you. I will take of the spirit that is upon you and will put the same upon them, and they shall bear the burden of the people with you. that you may not bear it yourself alone. Then you shall say to the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow you shall eat meat, for you have wept in the hearing of the Lord, saying, who will give us meat to eat? For it was well with us in Egypt. Therefore, the Lord will give you meat, and you shall eat. We shall eat not one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days, but for a whole month, until it comes out of your nostrils and becomes loathsome to you, because you have despised the Lord who is among you, and have wept. Why did we ever come up out of Egypt? And Moses said, the people whom I am among are 600,000 men on foot. Yet you have said, I will give them meat, that they may eat for a whole month. Shall flocks and herds be slaughtered for them to provide enough for them? Or shall all the fish of the sea be gathered together for them to provide enough to provide for them? Praise the Lord. Let me just pause it. You know, sometimes when God tells you some things, it defies human understanding. And Moses was going to say, they're talking of 600,000 adults. What animals are you going to kill here? If this is desert. Because he hadn't experienced God up to that point to understand the power of God. Anyway, let's continue. That's what we want to discuss. Like, you're going somewhere with this. I just wanted to read the fuller picture of it. And the Lord said to Moses, has the Lord's arm been shortened? Now you shall see whether what I say will happen to you or not. I pray that God will say things in our hearing that will challenge us to challenge our faith in God, and we will see the Lord. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered the 70 men of the elders of the people and placed them around the tabernacle. Then the Lord came down in a cloud and spoke to him, and took of the spirit that was upon him and placed the same upon the 70 elders. And it happened, when the spirit rested upon them, that they did what? Although, I'm sure the Old King James has a different word for that, but what it means is that it says, although they never did so again. They prophesied only that one time, and it never happened again. But again, like I said, that's not where we're going to. But this is similar to what happened in Acts chapter 2. Now, the two men had remained in the camp. You see, they had gone out to the tabernacle, and they had, they had spread around the tabernacle. But there were two of these 70 elders who were in the camp. They were not at the tabernacle when this thing happened. The name of one was Eldad, and the name of the other was Medad. And the Spirit rested upon them, even when they were in the camp and not in the tabernacle. As long as they were elders, chosen by, and there were 68 in that place and 2 in the camp, the Spirit of God went to those 2 in the camp. Do you understand that? And rested upon them. Now, they were among those listed, but who had not gone out to the tabernacle, yet they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses and said, Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp. You can see how their heart was. Their heart was about everything must be done in the tabernacle. They can't prophesy in the camp. It must be in the tabernacle. So Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, one of his choice men, answered and said, Moses, my Lord. Verse 29, which is the last verse I want to read. And that's where the key, that's where it said, God was answering Moses' prayer. This is Moses' prayer. Said, then Moses said to him, are you zealous for my sake? Oh, that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit upon. So basically, what Peter was saying to them is that, look, these tongues that you are hearing, this prophesying in different language, in different languages, which you understand, is manifesting his prophecy in time past. And I want to draw an inference here that the message of the Holy Spirit always answers the question, be it spoken or conceived. Anytime the Spirit of God is passing a message across, he will answer the question that is in your heart. whether you have spoken it or it is still in your heart to conceive. You are still conceptualizing it, he will speak. And if we are to speak for Christ, we must of the Holy Spirit. He is the one who knows the question in the hearts of men. He is the one who knows the question that those people have been asking for years and have not found. And he's the one who will give that answer of peace to such a person. The second thing I want to note about this Peter's spontaneous message, which was essentially the voice of Peter, but the message of the Holy Spirit, is that the message started from where the people were in their knowledge and understanding, and then took them to where they needed to be, salvation through Christ Jesus. Wherever they were, he started from there. And then he took them to where they ought to be. This is of the Holy Spirit. So no matter the conversation, no matter the discussion, he will start from where you are, but he's not going to leave you there. He will now take you to where you ought to be, the place of eternal salvation. In Acts chapter 8, we know that story already. Acts chapter 8, verse 29 to 35. The encounter between Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch on the desert road, who was reading a portion from the book of Isaiah and was wondering who the prophet was speaking to. But there's a statement that I want to read, verse 35. Now let me read 34. So the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this? Of himself or some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and beginning at where? This scripture. What did he do? He preached Jesus to him. Do you understand that? He started and then preached Christ to the man. The message of the Holy Spirit always seeks to take you from where you are, no matter how distant from God, no matter how steep in sin, no matter how ugly the situation, no matter how horrible the depression, no matter how extreme that condition may be, he will drive and bring you to God. He will bring you to the place of reconciliation. That is the plan of, that is the purpose of the message of God. The message of the Holy Spirit, the message that the Spirit of God has prepared from the foundation of the world, is to bring men to the place of reconciliation in God. In John chapter 16, verse 8 to 11, the Bible tells us about the work of God, was telling us what he will do when he comes. Let me just read it. It says, and when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. He will tell the world that whatever it is you are doing, whether it is by the laws of men, or by your culture, or by your grouping, it is sin. That once something is not of God, it is sin. He will convict the world of the righteousness that is in Christ Jesus alone. That no matter how much you try to be right with God, you are going to fail. You need to be tied to the righteousness that is in Christ Jesus. And then he's going to tell the world, preach to the world about judgment, that there is definitely going to be judgment. Sin has been judged, Satan has been judged, and judgment is going to take place on all those who choose to follow Satan. Because when it says of sin, because they do not believe in me, that's the sin of the world. The sin of the world is that they don't believe in Christ. I always use this illustration when I preach to people outside. Right now, in River State, there's for called members and kidnappers. Now, in the course of the amnesty, some people have brought their weapons and other things and they dropped them. Now, let's assume that there's somebody who is a known kidnapper or a cultist, having been given the amnesty, he refuses to drop his own weapon and goes on ahead to prosecute it. Now, what do you think they will do to him? Would they show him mercy?
No.
Exactly. So what is it that made that cultist or that kidnapper to enter the clause, as it were, of judgment? It is not so much the fact that he's a cultist, but because when he was granted amnesty, he did not grant it. So people are going to hell, not necessarily because of their sin, but because they refused to accept Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ had brought an amnesty, as it were, and saved man from sin, and said, now follow me. But men refused because they loved darkness. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit's message is coming to convict them of their sins, to tell them that you are sinners. In fact, when you read the conclusion in Acts chapter 2, verse 40, you will see what it is that the Lord, how the message of the Spirit of God is. It says, save yourselves from this perverse generation. Run away from your sinfulness. Run into the arms. Thirdly, the message started with the mundane and it pitched in Christ. That message started with, oh, tongues or no tongues, oh, prophecy or no prophecy, oh, in our language or not in our language. Then it now settled on Jesus Christ and made him front and center of the message. Peter said, you saw and heard him. Some of you may have seen him, and some of you may have heard him, or some of you may have heard about him. You heard about his signs, his miracles, the wonders, the message. You heard, you know, it's less than 50 days, or about 50 days ago, that he was crucified and buried. You know that. But I stand here to attest to you that he was raised from the dead. Along with this, my brothers and sisters, we witnessed it, that he's been raised from the dead. But don't just take my word for it. Let me lead you to what David, our king, who also was a prophet, what he said. David spoke about him. That's basically the message. Suddenly, the question they were asking, everything now revolved around who now? The Lord Jesus Christ. Like we read in Acts chapter 8, when the Ethiopian eunuch was reading and said, is this man speaking about himself? The Bible says, beginning at that scripture, Philip used that scripture and ministered Christ to him. In fact, let's read that scripture that man was reading in Isaiah 53. It was really Isaiah 53, as a matter of fact. It would be 52 and 53. But a portion of 53, 7 and 8 says, he was oppressed and was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. People, he was stricken. Of course, anybody reading this would be confused. What is it? Is this man writing about himself? How can somebody be in prison and be writing about himself? What is this about? And Philip started there and began to tell him about the Lord Jesus Christ. Began to say to him that this scripture is referring to the way and manner in which he will be judged, in which he will be crucified. The crucifixion, the imprisonment, the burial, and so on and so forth. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I want us to know the content of a typical message, so that when we go, we must zero in whatever our discussion is, it must come into this place. In 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4, Paul writes, he says, for I deliver to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for what? Our sins. According to the scriptures. And that he was buried. and that he rose again the third day. We must include the crucifixion. We must include the fact that he was buried. We must also mention the fact that he was resurrected. And we must know that he did not die because he wanted to show that he has power to raise himself up. He died because of our sins. And you and I now have life through him. Do you understand that? In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 to 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 to 5. Paul was writing to Corinthians and said, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That your faith should not be in the word, but in the power of God." When we do not preach this message as we ought to preach, in the power of God, what happens is that men's faith do not rest upon God. They rest upon us, something else. In Galatians chapter 3 verse 1, Galatians 3 verse 1, when Paul was writing, chiding the Galatians, in verse 1 he said, "Oh foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as..." Who is it that bewitched you to go and believe in circumcision for salvation? When I presented in a graphic manner, I illustrated as best as I could what the crucifixion of Christ meant and how it brought you out. And he went on to ask them, "When you began to speak in tongues, when you received the power of the Holy Spirit, were you circumcised? Was it not faith in the message of salvation that I brought to you by measure and his resurrection? As you believed it, that you received the gift of the Holy Spirit and began to manifest it in tongues, in other ways? How is it that now you want to leave that and now you want to begin to walk by circumcision?" The message, when the Spirit of God is giving his message, it always revolves around the Lord Jesus Christ, around his crucifixion, the death, the burial, the resurrection, and even the ascension. These are what I call the foundations of our teaching or preaching the message of salvation. We must have that in it. In John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, John 3, 14 and 15, "And as Moses lived, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting or have eternal life." Moses had symbolized what was going to happen to Christ in the wilderness, albeit by the instruction of God. He didn't know what was going to happen in reality, but he acted, and the Lord just said, This is how I was lifted up. In John chapter 8, we are going to verse 28 to 32. John 8:28 to 32. There are some two verses also that you will be familiar with, that you will see, but you will see the essence. Then Jesus said to them, "When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him." The old King James is the one that says, "And if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me." As he spoke these words, many believed in him. Then Jesus said to him, to those Jews who believed in him. If you abide in my words, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Because when he mentioned that he would be lifted up, you know, the people understood what he meant by lifted up. Where the ones they understand lifted up then. But they understood what he meant, that they will lift him up on the cross and crucify. But that was the method of killing. And they saw somebody who was speaking about death, his own death. And they believed that this must be the Christ. But then he now said to them, it is not enough for you to believe. You must also continue in my word. Because that is how you are going to be my disciples. And as you continue in that word, you will now be able to be delivered from the stronghold of sin. Now I'm going to read John 12. Now sorry, John 12 is where he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw men unto myself. John 12, 32 to 34. John 12, 32 to 34. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, this is how they did when they crucified him by the cross. The man was suspended, as it were. That's why the man lifted up from the earth. Will draw all peoples to myself. I will draw all men to myself. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. The people answered him, that the Christ remains forever. And how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? In their own understanding, the Christ does not die. The Christ cannot die. Even though the scriptures do not support it. But the Lord said, if I am lifted up, I will draw men unto myself. What does that mean? If we speak of his death, of his being lifted up on the cross, he will draw men. Men drawing men to themselves. Not Christ drawing men. Because you cannot preach a message that has nothing to do with the cross, and then people come forward and will say they have come to Christ. No, they came to you. They came to a man. Because when you preach Christ, when you preach the cross, and he draws those men to himself, those men will know instantly that they are sinners. You don't need to be begging them or cajoling them that they are sinners. They will recognize that he died for their sins. Don't ask me how it's done, but there's a power that does that. In Isaiah chapter 53, Isaiah wrote, he said, who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Who can believe this kind of report? What was he saying? Let's go to the chapter before 53, chapter 52. And I'll just read from verse 12. It says, for you shall not go out with haste, nor go by flight. For the Lord, from 13 to 15. Behold, shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Just as many were astonished at you, so his visage was marred. Do you understand? More than any man. He was talking about what would have happened by the time they finished beating Christ. If anybody has seen the, what's that thing now? The Passion of the Christ, you would understand. That Hollywood itself said it was too gory. Hollywood that shows all kinds of crazy, he said that was too gory. He said, many will be astonished. When you see his visage, there's nothing. Look at verse. He says, and his form, it's as though it was an animal by the time they finished tearing him with the whip. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths at him. For what had not been told them, they shall see. And what they had not heard, they shall consider. So Isaiah now says, who has believed that? Who can believe such a thing? In the world, even presently, no king dies for his subjects. But here, God is presenting a king that dies for his son. Isaiah says, who can believe our report? Who can believe such a thing? And if you read from verse 2, he says, for he shall grow up, I'm in Isaiah 53 now, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire. Let me tell you something. The message of the cross, there is no beauty in that message. And we're going to see that later. Now, one of the crucial things about the message of the cross is that it is the power. It is in that message. The intellectuals don't like that kind of a message. How can we talk about a religion or speak of something that is so gruesome and we say there's salvation in that thing? But that is how we're saved. The historians say, or rather, that history always repeats itself because men never learn from history. We need to go back to our foundation. We need to see how we started so that we can live as we should be living. Look at verse 3. He is despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And then we complain that men despise us. We complain that men are rejected. He was rejected. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Acquainted. Do you know what it means to say you have an acquaintance? A friend. He was friends with grief.